Very good morning to everyone this morning, and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies for today's meeting, and our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session about the cost of living crisis and its impact on lone parents. This session is in a round table format and follows on from last week's session, when we heard from organisations representing disabled people and unpaid carers. I'd like to welcome everyone, and we have in the room Martin Canavan, Head of Policy and Participation, Aberlour Children's Charity; James Dunbar, Chief Executive of New Start Highland; Cara Hilton, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Scotland Trussell Trust; Kirsty McKechnie, Early Warning System Project Manager, Scotland Child Poverty Action Group, Scotland; Satwan Rehman, Chief Executive Officer for One Parent Families Scotland; and Fiona King, Senior Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Save the Children. And joining us remotely is Morag Hanna, Chief Executive Officer from Sky and Lacalche Citizens Advice Bureau, and Laura Miller, Strategic Manager from Fife Gingerbreads. So thank you all for joining us today. We have again this week chosen a roundtable format to facilitate a free-flowing conversation. So the committee is very much in listening mode today. So please feel free to indicate to me when you want to come in. If you're attending online, please pop a wee R in the chat box and I'll bring you in. We have three themes today. I will kick off with the first theme, then invite Miles Briggs to introduce the second theme, and Katie Clark for theme three. We have approximately 30 minutes for each discussion. So let's start off with theme one, which focuses on how the increase of the cost of living has affected lone parents. We're interested to hear more about how things have changed for lone parents in the last year and what particular issues have had a greater impact on lone parent families. Also, if you can pick on where there are gaps in our knowledge and if you're aware of any research being undertaken on the issue, that would be really useful too. So I will kick off we'll have that open discussion and we're all ears. Satna.
Thank you. And I say thank you very much first and foremost to the committee for having this focus on single parents and the cost of living crisis. I just wanted to say a wee bit to start off with, there was some very good information in the SPICE briefing for this, giving the profile of single parents, and I think it's important for me just to summarise some of that, because that indicates what some of the issues are that we're having to address and why the impact has been so significant for single parents. And I think one of the things that we're really keen to point out, that it's the fact that there's been a series of cumulative issues through austerity, the pandemic, and then the cost of living crisis, which have exacerbated the situation for single parent families. And so what we're seeing is an impact materially on the family circumstances, but also in terms of physical and mental health of both the children and the parents. And the issues for this are manifold, and there's a lot of structural issues with how the labour market's working, employment that's on offer, the way services are structured, and the greater reliance on services that many single parent families have, because they have the sole responsibility for caring and earning. And from the summit yesterday, one of the things that came out, which is we hear a lot about from the single parents, is the incoherence in the way services are organised and delivered and the impact that that has on families. So in terms of single parents, the vast majority are women. So there's a gendered aspect to the inequalities that we're talking about here. 80% are actually aged between 25 and 50 years old, and most are in their mid-30s. So the vast majority of them have become single parents through relationship breakdown. 80% of single parents speak about experiencing discrimination and attitudes and assumptions that are made about them. They're more likely to live in deprived areas in the most deprived decile. And actually, in terms of paid work, which is often seen as a route out of poverty, although the poverty stats we have show that not to be the case for many families, but for single parents who are not in work, they're more likely to have low or no qualifications, less likely to hold a driving licence, and less likely to be in health that's good or very good. And if we're looking at the priority family groups and the Child Poverty Act, there's a 40% overlap between single parent families and those where either the adult or the child is disabled. So you're seeing compounding factors in terms of inequalities that families are having to cope with. And this profile is important because it points us in the direction of the policy actions that would be the most effective in reducing single parent poverty. So for each of the priority family groups in the Child Poverty Act, there's the general causes of poverty and then the specifics of each of the priority groups. And we think that's really keen and important when we're looking to see how do we respond and what do we put in place. The Living Without a Lifeline report, which was referenced in the invitation to this meeting, this round table, was our research with single parents on the cost of living crisis. And at that point, it showed 3 in 5 single parents are finding it either extremely difficult to afford or could no longer afford electricity. Almost 60% said the same about gas. Almost 44% said the same about food. More than 1 in 5 parents said they could no longer afford to buy clothes, pay for travel, or for childcare. And 1 in 10 single-parent households were in unmanageable debt, which is higher than any other household type. And so, like I said, part of the reason why there's this disproportionate impact is the pre-existing inequalities that there have been. But we also, since then, we do bi-monthly impact reports, which are sort of topic-based for single parents. And the key findings in terms of what's changed is debt. There's a big concern that single parent families are having around debt. We're not seeing any issues abating, so I can't come here with a good news story for you, other than the fact that single parent families are extremely resilient and creative in how they make do with very little. And that's something I think it's really important for the committee to note. But that they've been hit by this economic storm. And like I said, the vast majority are women, so we really are seeing the fact that there was a gendered impact of COVID and that coming through into an sort of exacerbated gendered impact of the cost of living. Energy costs and prepaid meters were big issues that came up, things that we can look at seeing how we address. And like I spoke, disability, many are supporting disabled children or have disabilities themselves. And these families were particularly vulnerable to the cost of living crisis because of the additional costs that they face. And I'll stop there, sorry. Otherwise, I'll keep on forever.
Satna, thank you very much for your comments. They're pretty stark, but really interesting comments that we will take on board. So thank you for that. I believe Morag Hanna would like to come in.
Morning, everyone. Yeah, it's just really the cost of living crisis continues to squeeze all household budgets, and I'm not sure if the committee had seen the record levels of demands that the latest data report found in March for Citizens Advice Bureau. It's helped more than 100,000 times in March, and it's the highest on record for the individual pieces of advice given in over 3.5 years. And then looking at that in March as well, it's normally food bank advice again, so it's showing the poverty levels and how people are needing to access the food. If I may give an example, which might kind of sum up why people are coming to CAB, and an example of a lone parent in Sky Lochalsh, we had a single parent of 2 children living in a very remote area, struggling with the increased food costs, very limited competition You know, we don't have the various supermarkets. It's a kind of one supermarket in the area. Access to the local food bank being an hour's drive away, so it's not a case of being able to just jump into a car or a public transport. In fact, regarding the public transport, there's only one school bus in the morning you can get, and then you can get the school bus on the way home at 3 o'clock. So then you'd be stuck in the village all day. That's probably not acceptable for her. That's the only services she has to reach the GP, the supermarket, and indeed the Citizens Advice Bureau, local authorities, etc. for help. Client was working part-time. She couldn't increase her hours due to the lack of childcare provision in her area, which is very limited. She was in a multiple debt situation with priority debts, including rent and council tax arrears, and she had significant electricity arrears, with legal action notices being served on her for eviction. Through various appointments, once she made that contact with the Citizens Advice Bureau, we used the one-named advisor approach, building on that trust and relationship between the advisor and the client. It's vital that lone parents don't feel judged. You can build up on that trust, especially in smaller communities where they may be worried about confidentiality. So it's really important that they know that everything they tell us is treated in the strictest of confidence. It was established the client had actually never claimed child benefit before, despite having two children. Didn't know that was her entitlement. She didn't know about council tax and co-occupancy. She didn't know about council tax reduction. She didn't know about universal credit claims. It presumed because she was working part-time that she wasn't entitled to any benefits. An initial assessment showed as well that she may also qualify for the adult disability payment due to her health needs. So, obviously, the CAB advisor assisted with the Scottish Child Payment. That followed once we did the universal credit claim. She'd never heard of the Scottish Child Payment before. That was an additional help coming into her household, the income. The advisor, the one named advisor that was assisting her, was an approved money advice worker, accredited through the Scottish National Standards. And that advisor was able to actually steer the client through the sequestration process through the MAP route, as she had debts of over £21,000. So sometimes initially when somebody approaches us, you don't find out the whole story initially, and it's all about building that trust relationship with them. And once they know that they're not being judged, the more they will disclose. And having these debts of over £21,000, being a lone parent, not having family, not having a partner to share that burden, if you like, with, was causing her mounting stress for her as well. So it was agreed that sequestration was actually the best option for her with no disposable income. The advisor was able to obtain a grant through the Home Heating Support Fund, and that was for £1,600, and that was to help her with ongoing electricity costs, all going forward. And the sequestration was approved with the debts written off. In relation to the unclaimed benefits, it amounted for that one client financial gain of over £16,000. Unfortunately, the adult disability payment's not yet known. The application was started on the 6th of December, so we're still waiting on that decision. So it's still ongoing, but we're hopeful that decision and that will come through, and that will be additional money coming into our household as well. I think it would be fair to say that a lot of her stress was alleviated going through the whole process, but I guess what I'm trying to say today is it's building up that trust relationship between a one named advisor and the client really does help. It's the CAB almost being a one-stop shop, being able to deal with the rent arrears, the electricity arrears, the mounting debts, access to food, energy, and just being there to support her throughout that process.
Thank you, Morag. Thanks for sharing that story of that family who live in a remote community, and also sounds like they've been completely isolated as well in their lack of awareness of what benefits are available to them. So thank you for that. I'm going to now bring in Cara Hilton. Thanks, Cara.
thanks, Commissioner. Do you just
You don't need to press anything. Press. Okay. Thank you, and thanks to the committee for sort of the focus on the cost of living crisis, because it certainly is having a devastating impact on the people that our network support across Scotland. We released our annual food bank parcel stats last week, and they found that there was. It's been the busiest ever period for our network in Scotland and indeed across the UK since the Trussell Trust began. We've seen a 30% increase in the number of families in Scotland who needed to use a food parcel. And alarmingly, almost 90,000 of those parcels were for children. That's the most parcels that our network has ever provided for children in Scotland. And that's up 24% on last year, up 57% on 5 years ago. And we're seeing more and more people having to use food banks in Scotland for the very first time. We've seen an extra 62,000 people in Scotland need to use a food bank for the first time last year. I'm told that's more than you could squeeze into Hampden Stadium, but not being a football fan, I couldn't verify if that's the case or not. But and I think when we look at our parcel stats, even though they're not actually broken down by the type of family, our previous research, which we published in spring 2021, State of Hunger, found that single parents, families with three or more children, were much more likely to need to use a food bank in Scotland. A quarter of food parcels distributed by our network in Scotland go to families with three or more children, and when that's much more, when you look at the general population, there's only 7% of families who have got three or more children, and almost one in four of our parcels goes to a lone parent household. And I think one of the most staggering things is that 70% of parcels go to people who have a disability or live with someone who does, and that obviously just shows you the scope, the scale of the situation we face. And we're going to be publishing some research on this next month called Hunger in Scotland, so obviously we'll share those findings with the committee when we do. But essentially, the cost of living crisis has been devastating because the families that our food bank support have already been cutting back on everything. They've already made every saving possible. They're not just choosing now between heating and eating. They're having to cut back on both, as Satwa talked about already. And people just don't have enough money to afford even the bare essentials. They can't afford to buy their kid a warm winter coat. They can't afford shoes. They can't afford to travel to work. The average person that's coming to one of our food banks, and when you think about the scale of the increase in need at the moment, they're living on just £8 a day after housing costs. You know, they've absolutely nowhere left to turn. And we know that the cost of living crisis is having a huge impact because we know that the costs that affect the lowest income households are rising disproportionately. The cost of food is up 19%, but the cost of some basic food items such as bread, cheese, pasta, some of those costs have more than doubled. And it's just people are really at breaking point. And I think it's really heartbreaking, some of the sort of stories that we are hearing at our food banks. It's people not just who people can't afford food, but they can't afford to use a cooker. They can't afford to keep the fridge turned on. You know, it's just staggering that we're having to do things like sort of change the hours that our food banks open so that this fit around the working day, because more and more people in work are having to use a food bank. We're having to give out more sort of kettle packs because people can only heat food that they from a kettle rather than a cooker. So yeah, in every community in Scotland we're seeing the devastating impact, and I think one of the things that worries us most is we know that this is just the tip of the iceberg. Someone that's coming to a Trussell Trust food bank, you know, that is the absolute last option. There's many tens of thousands, possibly hundreds of thousands more people across Scotland who are accessing food larders, pantries, who simply don't have enough money for the essentials. But we would say this doesn't just reflect the current cost of living crisis. It isn't just the impact of the pandemic. It's the fact that the social security system that we have here in Scotland and across the UK just doesn't provide people with enough money to live on. And too many people are in work that is precarious. It doesn't provide enough hours, enough income. They can't fit the there isn't enough flexible or affordable childcare that fits around the working day. And Satwa addressed the issue very well about the particular challenges that single parents face, and it's just simply because they just don't have enough income to meet the essential costs. And I think we need to be exploring all options to reduce costs, to maximise incomes possible, looking at things like maybe a lone parent premium to top up the Scottish Child Payment, things that we could do in Scotland with the powers that Holyrood has to just make people's lives easier and to increase people's incomes, because we know that it's cash in people's pockets that will make the difference.
So I think that's probably enough from me. I'll pass on to the next person.
No, thanks, Cara. And again, yeah, even from my own constituency, spoken to several constituents who used to actually donate to the food banks, who are now using them as well. And that's the stark reality of it. So thank you for sharing that information. So the next person we're going to bring in is Martin Canavan.
Thanks very much, Convener. And again, thank you to the committee for inviting us along to give evidence today. I'm probably going to be building on a bit of a theme in terms of what we've heard already. And I'm really keen to be able to represent and reflect not just what we are seeing in our work, but also what parents have told us, some in their own words, and I'll share some of that with you this morning. For those of you that don't know, Aberlour, one of the things that we do is we deliver our Urgent Assistance Fund, which is a hardship fund, which is accessible to all low-income families across Scotland, not necessarily those that already have contact with Aberlour or supported by Aberlour. And I think I've given evidence to this committee before about the use of that fund and the impact and demand on that fund, particularly since the time of the pandemic. And that hasn't relented, understandably, over the last period and in the last year. Just to give you a little bit of kind of top-line information around how the fund has responded specifically to single parents across Scotland. And we support and have supported families across, I think, 31 out of 32 local authorities through the fund across Scotland. So since April 2021, we've distributed over £1 million in small grants to families, single-parent families in financial crisis right across Scotland through our fund. Nearly two-thirds of the total number of families supported through our Urgent Assistance Fund are single-parent families, disproportionately, significantly disproportionately represented in terms of the families that we support, which I think gives an illustration of the level of deep financial crisis that so many single-parent families are facing. That's around 3,000 families, which equates to about 5,500 children across Scotland that Aberlour have supported in that time. In more than 90% of those cases, single parents that we support are mums, which is consistent with the national statistics, and in 80% of those families, the parent is unemployed and therefore relies entirely on benefits for their income. The majority of single parents, families supported through our Urgent Assistance Fund are young parents under 25, which I think speaks to some of the particular issues around discrepancies around income and value of income that single parents under 25 receive in terms of universal credit. And the main reasons for referral and requests for help and support that we see at Aberlour through our Urgent Assistance Fund, more than half, 51% of referrals are for help and assistance to buy children's clothing. 38% is for food, families who are really affected by food insecurity. 33%, so around a third, are for families who need help and support to pay utilities, essential bills. 22% is help with bedding, beds, mattresses for their children to be able to sleep. And 16% are for families who are in real dire straits in relation to debt and to help support families with problem debt. That doesn't tell us the whole story, though, about debt. And I'm going to say something more about debt in just a second, and I know that's a theme that we've already begun to touch on. But just to illustrate the point, or to give a little bit more of an insight from one of our parents who we spoke to in advance of coming along to this session this morning, one mum that we support up in Moray, who's a single parent of three, wanted to share her experience. And if the committee's okay, I'd be keen to share a short extract from that. So in her words, the cost of living is hard and stressful for a two-parent family. And little did I know when we split up the pressures ahead that I face as a single parent family every day. A single parent family has to carry everything on their shoulders alone. We have nobody to share the load. Yes, we may have supportive parents and friends. However, when things develop into more than just an odd favour, shifting into a regular theme in dependency, we catch ourselves and we stop asking as we value our relationships as equal. This is very important, to be treated with respect and as an equal. It seems that the very basics are far out of reach for me and mine at the moment. Things are not getting any better. I go to my friend's house for a cuppa, we're always made to feel very welcome, loved and wanted, they know the score. We don't meet at a cafe anymore, I couldn't afford to pay for that. I can't afford to buy packets of biscuits. If I did, my children would eat them all. They're not thinking about tomorrow and why should they? I can't afford the extra sugar and milk it costs, and never mind the cost of boiling the kettle. I know my children quietly worry about things well beyond their control. I try hard for them not to know the pressures, but it's difficult to keep turning them down when their friends are doing something, and I can't afford for them to join in. I tend to batch cook and freeze my meals. I try my hardest not to buy processed foods, but extremely difficult when they're so much cheaper than fresh and making from scratch. Batch cooking days are good, hard-working couple of days. I'm busy, the kitchen door is left open, and that helps to heat the house. I don't like using the oven unless I'm batch cooking. I don't buy the best meat or vegetables. Fruit is a luxury. I can't afford any brand names. I'm conscious about the lack of vegetables and nutrients that my children are eating and are certainly not eating the recommended portions every day. I use toothpaste and cleaning detergents sparingly. Once the cooking is all done, I worry about having enough to pay for the electricity to keep the freezer on. I have the hot water on a strict certain time. So if you ever come to my house and see dirty dishes in the sink that day, I'm not being lazy. It's because I'm being frugal. I could go on, but I think that maybe brings into some stark relief the direct impact of the cost of living and the circumstances that we're talking about for many of the families, not just at Aberlour or the Aberlour supporters, but across Scotland. In terms of Aberlour's work, some of you may be aware, and we've given evidence to this committee before, about our work around debt, specifically public debt. And I mentioned that debt is a key referral reason for families accessing support from our Urgent Assistance Fund. However, we've also been delivering a pilot service in Tayside over the last year or so, supporting families through our Family Financial Wellbeing Project, which is specifically supporting families who have unmanageable levels of problem debt. It's part of our extended family support, so alongside the practical support and emotional support that we offer families, this is in addition offering welfare advice, help and support to access entitlements, and where possible and where necessary, looking to write off some of those unmanageable debts for families. We've supported lots of families through that project, and many of them haven't required to have their debts written off once we've done all the welfare advice and help and support. But for those families that have gone all the way through our project in the last year, half of them have been single parents, single parent families. The total cumulative amount of support that we provided through that through our project in the last year, the total debt relief has been £38,500, and that's supported families to write off on average around £2,700 for those families. Around 90% of those debts were public debts, council tax and rent arrears, what we would call involuntary debts. And so I think that begins to build a picture and illustrate what we've said before to this committee and said in other spaces, is that the issue of debt, understanding the issue of the debt and the context of debt, is really important to understand and recognise in most cases. And overwhelmingly, we see this in the families that we support at Aberlour, single parent families included, is that debts that the families are burdened with are public debt. I'm going to pause there because I know other people are probably going to want to come in, but happy to build on that theme or come in at another point.
Martin, thank you so much for sharing that story of that particular family. I know it's heartening, albeit sad, to hear of the pilot scheme that you are rolling out. So thank you for sharing that information. Can I bring in Fiona King, followed by Kirsty McKechnie?
Thanks, Marina. I think, as Martin said, there's starting to chime the key themes from across the sector. And I think, whilst I don't want to repeat what's already been said, I think it's really important that the committee do take away that there is a consistency here and that all of the organisations, despite representing slightly different parts of the puzzle, are experiencing the same things. We've heard really articulately that lone parents are disproportionately at risk of experiencing poverty across Scotland, and the stats abound. But I think it's really important to understand that being a lone parent, whilst you're disproportionately at risk of poverty, your choices are diminished. And I think that's an important part of the issues and why there does need to be a particular focus on lone parents, because the choices that you have around your work pattern, your childcare options, your travel, who can pick up, your wraparound, they are diminished at the time. So it's a bit of a double whammy for lone parents. And I think lots of what's already been said and Martin articulated really, really powerfully, individual case study of someone they've worked with, but at Save the Children, we're seeing very similar things. So we also distribute emergency early years grants. Like many other third sector organisations, we're seeing around 70% of those go to lone parent families. So that the national stats are borne out in third sector stats, that there is a disproportionate reliance on that emergency cash from lone parents, because as Cara articulated so clearly, they just have nowhere left to turn. And again, the vast majority are women. And I think it does highlight the fact that we do have a fundamental inadequacy in incomes, and that needs to be addressed. So whilst I welcome the focus on cost of living, and that's absolutely critical at the moment, child poverty levels have been pretty static across Scotland, predating the pandemic and the cost of living crisis. So a lot of these families were already living on the very lowest incomes before the tsunami of everything that's happened in the last few years. And so they have been living on very low incomes and cutting back and balancing really tight budgets. And the cost of living crisis is really compounding those structural inequalities. So we must focus on emergency crisis response, but we also need to look at the longer term changes on how we're going to get Scotland to the place we want it to be, which is a Scotland free of poverty, where we're meeting those 2030 targets and less than 10% of children are experiencing poverty. And we need to do that for the individuals involved and for the children, and but also for the outcomes of the children, for the stress levels and mental health and well-being of the parents, but also at a society level. We don't, you know, the high levels of poverty that this country's experiencing, it has a cost on sort of all of us. So The parents that we've been supporting and working with, very similar to others, but the main reason people are coming to us is for those basics. And I think that point really needs to be hammered home. This isn't about luxuries or days out or additional extras. Mainly food, but also children's shoes has become increasingly important, and bedding. So pretty low cost items, but that they don't have the cash to buy. And I think the point about the stress on parents has been brought up, but parents are saying to us things like the stress of always having to make cutbacks and assess what you can and can't afford is deeply affecting my mental health. And that we hear that every time we speak to parents. But I also think I really want to make the point that the system is still too complex. I think Morag really articulated in that case study how difficult it is to navigate the system. You're dealing with UK benefits, Scottish benefits, different pots of cash. The third sector is to a certain extent filling a gap by providing lots of emergency grants and emergency relief, but that's also complicated. You're needing to work through the system, and if you are a lone parent and you're already doing everything on your own, it is overwhelming, and that's what we're hearing from the parents we're working with. This is overwhelming and there's no end in sight, so the kind of cumulative impact on parents is substantial. But as Save the Children, we're particularly concerned on the long shadow this is casting on children experiencing poverty. We know that children, the longer children experience poverty, the greater and deeper the impacts can be. And of course, we need to not look at resolving issues of poverty in a silo, because this is also about the attainment gap and the long-term health and well-being of the children. And I think Cara's stats around the number of children in Scotland who are needing food parcels, that should be a cause for great alarm to this Parliament, because if that's increasing at the time when we're supposed to be moving towards a Scotland where we have very low levels of child poverty, I think that really just underlines the fact that we need to do more and do it quicker to meet the targets, but much more importantly, to improve outcomes for children and give all children in Scotland an opportunity to grow and thrive in the way that I think we all would want them to. So I think it's that complexity, and a parent described it to us as a web, and it's like trying to work your way through a web and piece it all together. So I think, I know we'll get into childcare and employability and what maybe the specific policies are, but I think it's not about more little pots and more funds and bits and bobs. I think it must underline the importance of a cash-first approach. If we can get more cash into the families, into the pockets of the families and the parents who need it, they know their family, they know the choices, they know their local area, they know the supermarkets, they know their travel routes. That's the best way to respond to the poverty that lone parents and all parents are facing, is to give more cash so they can have the choices. And so I'm sure it will come up, but I think one of the key things that could and should be done is to increase the value of the Scottish child payment to at least £40 a week, rather than pots of cash. And it's not about little bits and bobs, it's more money in pockets so that those choices and actions can be taken. So I'll leave it there, but I think it's important that we come on to childcare and employability.
Thanks very much, Fiona, for the points. It was really interesting. I'm conscious of time. I know we set us at a 30-minute slot, so and I also want to bring everybody in. So if you could be, you know, as succinct as possible. Thank you.
Okay. will be. Thank you. Because I think everybody's teed me up really nicely, just to add in a wee extra point about why lone parents were so exposed to the cost of living crisis in the first place. We know that 24% of children in Scotland are in poverty, and for lone parents, households, that increases to 38%. SatWatt's talked about what the reasons for that are. No second earner, more likely to be working part-time, availability of childcare costs, all of those structural things. But all of these things also mean that lone parents are more likely to need to supplement their income through Social Security. And between 2013 and 2020, benefits were either frozen — this is UK benefits, such as universal credit or tax credits — they were either frozen or the increases were capped at 1%. So by the time we went into the pandemic, the value of benefits in terms of what they covered was much lower than it had been at the beginning of the decade. So as the cost of living had gone up over the decade, the value of the benefits hadn't. So even as we were going into the pandemic, the value of the benefits was much lower than it had been a decade before. And we know that from some of our early warning system case evidence that for the lowest income families, the cost of living crisis isn't new. We had already been receiving reports of lone parents who weren't eating just so that they could feed their children, or not using power because they couldn't afford to. For them, the cost of living crisis isn't something new. It's just that it's affecting more people. And I think lone parents were particularly exposed to the cost of living crisis because there just wasn't anything else to cut back on.
Thank you for that, Kirsty. And I'm now going to bring in Laura Miller, who's online. And then following that, it's James Dunbar. And that ends the theme one. And I'll pass on to Miles Briggs. Thanks.
Good morning. I'll make a really short point because I'm conscious of time. But I think that the main thing at Fife Gingerbread we're starting to see is a real increase in the stress and anxiety. Do you know, as a lone parent, you're that main carer, you're the main source of income, however that income comes in the household. And we are seeing a real change in that and compounding all those issues in households. And it is driven by that constant budget and every penny and surviving. And I think it's a really important point to make, is that a lot of the families we're working with are really in survival mode, and it's really focusing on providing essentials like we've talked about today. And I think as part of this conversation, it has been touched on by colleagues, is that we cannot lose sight of the fact that we have children and young people unable to live full, rich lives and participate in their communities. So we're seeing a lot of families where there's early years developmental delay, isolation, the attainment cap, play poverty, unable to take part in hobbies and activities, healthy diets. So there's a real lack of proper participation in our communities. And that's just the additional point that I'd just like to emphasise as part of the conversation, that we don't lose sight of that.
Thank you, Laura. I really appreciate that. I'm now going to bring in James. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Thank you, committee. I will be really, really brief. One of the things we've noticed in rural Highland is there seems to be, as there's more pressure on resources, services that should be more person-centred are less person-centred. And we're having the public sector more mindful of expense over a wraparound person-centred service. I think that's a really important point. I also agree with everything that's been said before, so I don't have to say very much here. Other thing we've seen is a lot of people who are single parents are finding themselves in a place of hopelessness and dropping into a place of almost wanting to avoid what's going on. And some of our support workers are finding people with bundles of letters. Some of these letters contain good news, but the situation has become so difficult for them, and they have become so isolated that they're in a place of hopelessness, and they're actually avoiding dealing with a lot of things. So I would agree with everything that's been said, and I will keep this contribution that brief. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to pass over to Miles now to commence with theme two.
That's great. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us here today and online as well. I wanted to ask some questions with regards to current policies, and I'll maybe ask them both at the same time so everybody has a chance to touch on them. The first is with regards to actions set out in the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. And whether or not you believe these need to be revisited, given what we've heard already today with the rising cost of living challenge. And then I'd also like to know if you could provide any examples of existing policies which are particularly effective and policies you think have been less effective. We've obviously heard around child payment from many of you today, but just wondering if we could gather that sort of information. So happy whoever wants to kick off on that point. We start from the beginning.
Okay, fine. I was sort of hoping somebody else would start off this time, and I'd say I agree with them. I know, absolutely, Miles, absolutely. I mean, in terms of your first question with the delivery plan and do we need to revisit it, I think it needs to be kept under constant review because the situation and the circumstances are changing. But in general terms, if we were wanting to look at how we revisited and refocused the plan, I think we need to be more explicit about the links between child poverty and women's poverty and really build on that. I know we're going to talk about employment and employability, but actually we need to make it work for mothers. We need to make it work for parents. And I know we've got the Parent Employability Support Programme that's out, but at the moment the sort of generic approaches aren't providing the support that's required for single parent families and other priority family groups that there are. Childcare, and I think we need to be looking at childcare as an enabler, but also as a source of employment. I think we need to be thinking about how we can make best use of and invest in the social infrastructure, which provides employment opportunities, but also the consistent support that's required by single parent families. And I'd like to see stronger monitoring of actions and impact. What's actually making the difference in the plan? What isn't? What do we continue? What do we need to roll back on? And I've spoken earlier about the crossover between priority family groups, so I think you need to look at this in an intersectional way. What are the particular factors? And I do think the Scottish Child Payment, we see it is making a big difference to the families who are receiving it. However, the cost of living is outstripping it and the impact of it, and that's why we would be supporting the call for there to be an increase to £40 per week per child. But then within that, I think it's really important to look at what difference is that making to single parent families, and as Cara spoke about it, is there a premium we need on top of that? If we're thinking about this in terms of equity, it means we're not having to do the same for everyone, but we need to look at the specifics of the circumstances the families and the priority family groups are in. We think absolutely the cash first approach that's being adopted in terms of how we tackle poverty in Scotland is the right thing, and that's why an increase in Scottish Child Payment would make it so much simpler for families. What Fiona spoke about in terms of the complexity of the landscape is something we hear about all the time. And one of the parents that we worked with spoke about actually all her time is spent managing herself in poverty. You know, it's not about being able to lift themselves out of poverty. It's about managing it a little bit here, a little bit there, something here. But actually, then all your time is spent doing that. Childcare, we would argue that from what we're hearing from single parents is that whilst the rollout is making a difference, there are issues with availability, accessibility, and particularly flexibility of childcare that we need to be considering, because many of the types of employment single parents go into tend to be entry level, very little flexibility that suits the parent, lots of flexibility required on the part of the employer. And we don't have a childcare system with that level of flexibility built in to support them. Homelessness and housing, I think, are big issues that we need to be thinking about how we address if we're serious about tackling child poverty.
Issues that have been commonly highlighted were unaffordable properties, spiralling mortgage or rent increases, bad credit, cramped conditions, poor living standards and poor standards of property maintenance. So one of the things I think we need to be looking at, and many others will have called for this, is how we invest in social housing and actually meet the commitments that we've got around social housing and affordable housing. In terms of employment, I'll just say one thing about employability and then I'll stop to give it an opportunity to others. If we're looking at Fair Start Scotland, for example, the 2021 evaluation shows single parents were only 9% of those who'd joined Fair Start Scotland. 2,700 single parents had started with Fair Start Scotland over a three-year period, but only 200 were in paid work after that, which begins to highlight some of the things we need to be changing when we're looking at employability support. And actually, that type of cycling in and out of work is very typical pattern among single-parent families, but it has the consequences of disruptions to benefits, increasing the impact of debt repayments, having to give up childcare arrangements, put in place and paid for by universal credit, which impacts on children's experiences as well as parents' confidence. So I think one of the things when we're looking at new policies and ways that we can address the circumstances later, we'd want to look at how we can develop more bespoke employability programmes or go back to ones that have worked in the past, but which may have been time-limited. Parents that we work with, some of the older parents who remember it, still talk about how valuable Job Centre Plus's New Deal for Lone Parents was. The supportive approach, you know, the person-centred, integrated approach. Working for families was a great model we had here in Scotland because it took the family-centred approach. And I think when we're looking at all these policies, one of the things I'm really keen for us to do is to look at generally what's going to work, but then really drill down into what the specifics of what's going to work for single-parent families. How do we create that bespoke offer, be it employability, be it childcare, be it looking at the levels of income that need to be increased through social security?
Thank you. That was a lot in there. Thank you. No, that's very helpful, Martin. Yeah.
Thanks. So just to reiterate the point that others have made, but I think it's important and we can't state this enough. Aberlour, like some of the organisations around the table, is a member of the NGL Poverty Coalition, and we've got a very clear collective position on the Scottish Child Payment, which is that we think it should be raised to £40 per child per week, and that would go some way to addressing the lack of income, the cost of living impact and other issues that are impacting on all families, low-income families, but specifically on single-parent families also. On top of that, I think there's been, we've had some discussion over the last couple of days around the provision of free school meals, some considerations around the kind of universalism and the rollout into P6 and P7. We would absolutely advocate for continuing with the commitment to extending free school meals to P6 and P7. And we know that food insecurity is a key issue for low-income families. And again, I think through some of the statistics and the anecdotal evidence we've heard this morning, we know that food insecurity is a particular and significant issue for single-parent families too. And so continuing with the commitment to universal free school meals and then considering what that free school meal offer could look like also for high school-aged children. One of the things Aberlour and others have been calling for is thinking about how we might raise the income thresholds for families in order to increase and extend the number of families that reaches. Could be something we're thinking about in relation to high school age children. And also that would have the effect, we believe, of addressing the issue specifically of school meal debt, which is something Aberlour have been looking at and doing work around, which many of you will know, and the issue for low-income families who are just above the income thresholds and who don't qualify for free school meals. And again, single parents are overly represented, disproportionately represented in that group. So that's some of the things in terms of current commitments or current policies that we think could be extended or continued. I think also that the Oh, the other thing probably to say, it's important just to reflect the value and the importance of increasing the cash-first approach and increasing the Scottish Child Payment. It's coming back, not wanting to labour the point about debt and public debt, but coming back to some of the work that we've done over the last year, is to highlight that 80,000 families, low-income families across Scotland, in receipt of universal credit and with children, are currently having deductions from their monthly income through universal credit. That equates to about £80 per month for those families. Again, single-parent families are significantly represented within that group. And effectively, what that is having the effect of is wiping out or cancelling out the impact of the Scottish Child Payment entirely for a child in that family. And so that, I think, gives us even more urgency as to why we need to increase the value of the Scottish Child Payment, as well as tackle the issues and the challenges around debt and the ongoing debt crisis, which I think is fair to describe it as, that we're seeing in Scotland for low-income families right now. Satwat has already talked about housing as well. I think it's really important to understand also the effects of the debt and the public debt, particularly in relation to rent arrears that many families experience, including many single-parent families. And that is that families who have a rent arrear are unable then to move into more suitable accommodation and housing. Local authorities or social landlords won't allow them to move until the arrears are cleared. And so those families are trapped in debt, particularly when that debt is a rent arrear or housing arrears. It then has the effect of creating difficult challenges around their housing circumstances and housing situations. So I think that's another really key issue and area to look at, and begins to make the connections between income, debt, housing, and the way in which all these policy areas overlap and the effects one policy and one action within one policy area will have on another. I think one of the other things that's really important to highlight, and we see this in our work around domestic abuse and our domestic abuse services, but single-parent families are 1.5 to 2 times more likely to experience or have experienced domestic abuse. And the issue of financial challenges, financial challenges that families face, is almost universal through the domestic abuse services and the families that we support at Aberlour, who have experience of domestic abuse, often trapped and burdened with debt that's been built up as a result of partner and ex-partner, and then often, more often than not, single parents who are mums are left with substantial amounts of debts, be that council tax, housing arrears, even drugs debts are some of the things that we see in terms of families that we're working with. So understanding the particular context of domestic abuse in relation to single parents and how we then target and think about actions that build on what is an existing child poverty strategy, but also other actions that we might need to take to target support effectively to address the particular financial challenges and financial pressures on single parents specifically. So I think I've kind of covered a couple of areas there, and I know others will have lots to say about some of those, so I'll just pause there if that's okay.
Thank you, Martin, and can I just mention to Miles, we've got a wee list of people who are wanting to contribute as well, so yes. So, no, if Cara had indicated.
No, thank you, convener, and yeah, obviously I would echo what Satwat and Martin have said. I think we do need to revisit the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, because the Scottish Government and every party in this Parliament is determined to tackle child poverty. It's really clear that the actions that are being taken at the moment and the pace of those actions simply isn't enough either to meet the interim or the final child poverty targets. And Martin and Fiona and Sam have shared so powerfully the impact that has on children in Scotland who are growing up in a cycle of poverty. But this isn't about statistics, as we've heard. You know, this is about children's life chances. It's about their well-being. And there really is an urgency about this. We talk so much about poverty being a priority, but we need to be using all the levers that we have if we're going to address that effectively. And this needs to be embedded across all government departments, between central and local government. And as Satwat has said, we need to make sure that there's the much, much stronger focus on impact too. And so really bold action is needed. And I would echo the comments that have been made about this needs to start with increasing the Scottish Child Payment again to £40 a week, and also committing to increase that in line with inflation to ease the cost of living pressures and to meet our targets. We were disappointed that it wasn't increased in line with inflation this year. Obviously, we welcome the increase to £25, but Our research that we conducted last year with Save the Children Scotland and IPPR found that increasing the Scottish Child Payment to £40 a week would lift an extra 30,000 children out of poverty. And I think the Scottish Child Payment is a great example of a policy that is starting to make a positive difference now that it has been scaled up and extended to cover young people aged up to 16. And there's a much greater awareness, certainly in some parts of Scotland, about how to claim. We know that it's starting to make a difference because when we released our annual parcel figures last week, it does look like there was a much lower percentage increase in the number of parcels for children from November 2022 to March 2023, and I think that is really, really encouraging news. But I think what I would emphasise is that isn't an excuse for complacency, because firstly, it's still the case that we're seeing more children in Scotland having to receive a food parcel than ever before. But secondly, because if £25 a week is starting to reduce the need for food banks, increasing that payment to £40 a week would make an absolutely huge difference, both to families who would benefit, but also to the ambition that we all hold to meet Scotland's child poverty targets. And I think we should also need to explore how to use the success of the Scottish Child Payment to increase the incomes of other households and priority groups who are struggling the most and feeling the impact of some of the UK less regressive, sort of more regressive policies, I guess it is, such as young payment families who are affected by the young parent penalty, larger families who are impacted by the two-child cap, and people most at risk of using a food bank. And another policy that we think works really well is the availability of cash grants in a crisis from the Scottish Welfare Fund. That stands in stark contrast with what we see with welfare assistance schemes in other parts of the UK. It gives people dignity, it gives people choice, but if we're going to allow that scheme to make more of an impact, if we're going to reduce the number of families that need to turn to a food bank, then the Scottish Welfare Fund really does need to be properly resourced and to ensure that it meets the growing demand, because demand for the crisis support has never been higher. And that also needs to include the admin backup to be able to afford the staffing so that people who need support can get that support quickly. We want to see people get support within the same day, and that's really important if we're going to avoid the need for a food bank referral or people getting into the spiral of debt that Martin has talked so powerfully about. And as others have said, all the evidence does suggest that cash support in a crisis reduces the need for food banks. So we need that investment put in place so people do get that support right across Scotland, and that people are properly sort of signposted to income maximisation and advice services, and that those services are properly invested in. Because ultimately the problem that we face is a lack of income. And we hope to see this approach at the centre of the Scottish Government's action plan to end the need for food banks. This was supposed to be published in autumn, so we're waiting impatiently for that to be published, hopefully very soon. And also finally, in summing up, I would just echo the comments that Martin said about universal free school meals. We do really think a universal approach is absolutely vital. It reduces the stigma that we face, especially in our high schools, where we know that young people don't want to be identified as having a free school meal. And so it's absolutely vital that we have a universal system, that that system is rolled out as soon as possible for all children in our primary schools, nurseries, secondary schools, because that's important to make sure that we don't have children going hungry in our schools. And it's absolutely vital, as Fiona said too, to tackling the attainment gap that is a huge challenge for us in Scotland. So I think that's enough for me at this point.
Okay, thanks very much, Cara. We've now got another, I think it's three or four people wanting to come in, so I'm conscious of the time. So again, if I could ask you to be as concise and succinct as possible. Fiona, can I bring you in? And then after Fiona, I'll bring in Kirsty. Thanks.
Thank you. Just to add, I suppose, to what's already been said, we produced a report last summer looking at the action plan with Joseph Rowntree Foundation and went through it and appraised what the strengths and weaknesses were. And I think our overall conclusion was that the sort of diagnosis of the problem was correct. It correctly identified lots of the issues that we've been speaking about today. But perhaps the route map to resolving those remains a little bit opaque. It's not clear how we're targeting effective policies to each of the priority groups to drive down the disproportionately high rates of poverty for all of those six priority groups. I wonder if we are revisiting the action plan, do we need to look at specific targets per per priority group and think about how we stratify and kind of target that support. I think the question about universalism versus targeted is an important one when resources are stretched, but I think we would echo the point that Free School Meals is not the correct policy to roll back on that universalism for all of the points that have been well made. That's pivotal. But I think also we need to not look at each policy intervention in a silo. Free School Meals obviously is a poverty reduction mechanism, but it's also a health mechanism. It's a public health. It's the attainment gap. So looking at like return on those pounds spent, Free School Meals is a good one. So we strongly support maintaining that commitment and others. But I do think we need a balance of universal services where the evidence is there that that's effective, and then more targeted approaches. And to your question, Miles, around things like childcare and employability, I think it's not clear, as Satvat said, how effective the employment schemes are for the different targeted groups. And I think we think it's really important. There's a lot of talk about how we bring parents closer to the labour market. I think we'd flip that and say, how do we bring the labour market closer to parents? How do we incentivise businesses or employers to upscale their flexible part-time hours that can work around childcare, think about working from home in non-traditional work from home sectors, because the parents we are speaking with, and others have touched on this, but the kind of Rubik's Cube of getting a job and getting childcare that works for those hours or those shifts or the work pattern that you've got. And if you are a lone parent, you've got to do drop-off and pick-up, and you've got to get there, and you've got to get to your job. And you may work an inconsistent shift pattern. We know there's an inequality in the roles, and we're mainly talking about women, and that's low-paid work in carers' roles often, or hospitality, some of those much more flexible shift patterns and things. So We welcome the approach on employability, but I think there's two things for us. One, the point's been well made that a lot of the families we're talking about right now are in such crisis that employability seems quite a way away when you're thinking, I can't turn the light on or I can't turn the fridge on. So I think it's building towards that. But also we need to think about the barriers that each of the priority groups in the action plan face and the cumulative effect of those, and then think about employability programmes that really get in about that, because one like employability program won't work for all of the different priority groups because there's multiple barriers to how you can access employment. And I just wanted to read out a quote from a parent that we've been working with. So they said, so I'm stuck, I can't do a course, I can't do work, and I can't get childcare because the youngest is only 7 months. I'm just stuck. I was told that if I get a job, it would really affect my benefits. I wanted to speak to someone, but I don't know who to speak to about how much it will affect my benefits. It's like you're stuck in a position where you're needing to work, but you've got no support to get there. And I think that probably, in a nutshell, is our view that at the moment the job market is too far away from the lone parents that we're talking about. And I think in terms of childcare, we hear consistently and persistently that childcare, we really welcome and support the 1140 hours and that childcare offer. But there's almost an implementation gap, and a lot of the parents that we're speaking to, that it just doesn't work for them. It's not flexible enough, it's not close enough, or the top-up that they're needing to pay to in addition to the 3 hours, is more than the income they're taking home from their part-time job. So we need to iron out those inconsistencies and the kinks in the childcare offer, because for too many mothers, basically, it's not working for them.
Okay, thanks, Fiona. Can I bring in Kirsty now?
Conscious of time, I'll just support everything that everybody has said so far and then come on to one wee niche bit, which is we particularly welcomed the announcement the Scottish Government would mitigate the benefit cap in full, or as full as possible, within the legislative framework through discretionary housing payments. Capping benefits through the benefit cap means that we've completely lost the relationship between the level of benefits that are paid and the amount that people actually need to live on. But We know that as time goes on and more children are born after 2017, fewer families are going to be affected by the benefit cap because they're affected by the two-child limit instead. So quite simply, they won't get enough or won't be entitled to enough benefit to be capped in the first place. So whilst we welcome the mitigation at the moment, we know that the cost of that will reduce and that moving forward, that the two-child limit is going to become the bigger issue for families instead. So we would recommend that we look ahead to this and start to think about making additional payments through the Scottish Child Payment to families affected by the two-child limit. Recent Scottish Government analysis suggests that in terms of reducing child poverty, the two-child limit would be the most effective, cost-effective UK welfare reform to reverse. And our own analysis suggests that mitigating the two-child limit would lift between 10,000 and 15,000 children in Scotland out of poverty at a cost of around £85 million. So the most practical and effective way to address the impact of the two-child limit would be through an additional payment, the Scottish Child Payment, to households who have a third or subsequent child born after the 6th of April 2017.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm also, I've been alerted that there's two members in the room that want to ask you questions on this. So I'm going to quickly bring in Paul and then our deputy convener, Gordon. If you could be as quick as possible, please. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Convener. It was actually to Fiona's point about childcare. Obviously, when the 1140 hours came in, we had the two-year-olds, and obviously a lot of that work was to try and get parents back into work. I mean, have you seen any analysis of that, or do you feel that the government needs to do more analysis of what happened in that two-year-old space and how we might be able to expand and improve that?
I think the eligible twos is good targeting for low-income households, but the uptake is lower than the three-plus offer. And I think there's a multitude of reasons for that, but there isn't been enough analysis into why that is. And it comes back to those cognitive barriers. I think there's lots of individual reasons. There's community factors. There's logistical factors. But also there's an awareness raising around that, but there's also potentially a little bit of stigma we hear from some of the parents that we're working with, because it isn't a universal service if your two-year-old qualifies for an eligible two place. So I think we welcome that the eligible two scheme, but I think more needs to be done to target uptake and encourage uptake. And I think the new First Minister has made some references to expanding childcare and doing further targeting. And I think increasing the uptake of the eligible twos would be an obvious first step, but I think it has to be built in with choice and flexibility, because otherwise it's not an offer. If you can't take up the place, it's not a genuine offer.
Mm. Okay, thanks, Paul. Gordon, can I bring you in?
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I've heard a lot of good suggestions this morning, the £40 child payment increase, the loan parent premium, etc. But all of that is mitigation against a situation where the UK government, Kirsty mentioned earlier on about the fact that we saw benefits frozen or 1% uplift. Using the Bank of England CPI calculator, it suggests that 2013 benefits should have been increased by 30%. There is only a limited amount the UK, Scottish Government can do, given the fact it has to balance its budget every year. So should there be more of a call on the UK Government to look at minimum wage, look at employment law, look at benefit levels, and look at the two-child limit? Because all of that would make a substantial difference to poverty in Scotland, more than asking child payment to increase from £25 to £40.
Absolutely. I think I have colleagues in London who will be calling on the Westminster government to scrap the benefit cap, to scrap the two-child limit, all of these things. But in the meantime, in order to reach the Scottish child poverty targets, we have to use all the powers that we have and all the levers that we have in Scotland in order to make sure that we're taking the actions needed to get there.
OK, thanks, Kirsty. I've now got James, who wants to come in, and I think that's the last person. Oh, sorry, my apologies. I've got Morag and then James, sorry. So Morag's online. Thank you.
Thanks, Camilla. The Scottish Government rightly identifies a number of families who are particularly at risk of child poverty. CAVS in the past year helped single parents' families unlock £23.7 million in client financial gains. And, you know, it's more about supporting, making clients, single parent families, aware of what benefits, their entitlements are out there that they're not actually claiming, and getting them that support, that one named advisor support for them to build up that trust, like I mentioned earlier. We very much welcome the First Minister's commitment to increase the Scottish Child Payment, and also consideration to remove the 20-metre rule in disability benefit assessments as well, which I think would assist and really encourage both these policies to be progressed as a matter of urgency. Very quickly, one of the other things with regards to the Scottish Child Payment, perhaps not linking it to a qualifying benefit, looking at income threshold, for example, because I'm aware, certainly in our Bureau in Skymouth, sometimes there's lone parents who are working part-time that, whilst they might be able to claim universal credit, and the universal credit for them might work out to be £5 a week or £10 a week, and then it would then passport them into getting other benefits, such as the Scottish Child Payment. Some families or some lone parent families are choosing not to go down that road because of the difficulties with being on a universal credit claim. The difficulties of maybe perhaps, you know, managing that claim, the digital access, working with their work coach, having them to, you know, look for additional hours, up to 35 hours a week, and they just don't want that additional pressure for that extra £10 a week. So it's maybe looking at an income threshold as well, rather than just looking at you have to be on a qualifying benefit in order to get the Scottish Child Payment. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Morag. Can I now bring in James, who will be our final speaker in theme two? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to echo something Martin said about people fleeing, women primarily fleeing domestic abuse, and one of the things we've become aware of is how difficult it is for them sometimes to get access to benefits because a coercive controlling male tends to keep control of finance. And it seems to be, from our anecdotal experience, one of the reasons I know typically people go back seven times before they manage to break free from an abusive relationship. And I wonder if it was easier for the benefits to go to the mum and quicker, it might make life for mums fleeing domestic abuse easier. Other point was what Satwa said about employability and the importance of not reinventing the wheel. There are some models that don't work, some models that do, and it would be good to look at employability training, because that's, you know, employment is one of the routes out, along with good access to suitable childcare. And in Highland, the geographic location of the childcare and employment and the children's schools, all of that matters to make it practical. Cara touched on Scottish Welfare Fund, and I would ask that there would be something done both for more resource for Scottish Welfare Fund, but also that Scottish Welfare Fund would be more consistent. We deliver the furniture side of Scottish Welfare Fund in Highland, and depending where the priority is for the point of the month, the same person may get what they need or not. It just depends on demand over a period. And also, we find that dads don't always, you know, separated dads seem to be lower down the priority list with Welfare Fund, but for children to be brought up by two parents, albeit they may be separate, but wishing to have a positive contribution into the children's upbringing, they need to be able to have a good environment in their home for their children. And the final point I would say is just thinking about the third sector. I hear things about up to 30% of the third sector could disappear, because of the pressures it's under. I just think we need to be mindful that third sector is where a lot of people find as their final port or final refuge, and just being mindful of what we can do in the face of reduced resources to protect valuable services.
Okay, thanks very much, James. Okay, and we're now going to move on to theme three, and I'm going to bring in Katie Clark. Thanks, Katie.
And theme three is about new policies, and we've actually had quite a number of suggestions of new policies in themes one and two. I was going to read them out, but there's far too many of them, so I'm not going to do that. And as the Deputy Convener says, many of the levers lie at Westminster, but at the same time, this Parliament and the Scottish Government has substantial powers, both areas that are very much its own responsibility, but also the ability to mitigate as well. So in terms of developing some of the themes that we've already raised, what new policies do you think that we need to prioritise to tackle specific issues that have been identified in relation to loan parents? And are there any that actually probably wouldn't cost significant amounts of money that maybe might be easier to prioritise in the current situation? And what permanent changes do you think we need to make? Particularly given that the Scottish Parliament does have extensive responsibility for social security, and you know, we have to develop our social security system in Scotland in a different way. So how would you develop maybe on some of the themes that have already been raised? And maybe if I go to Kirsty first, if she's comfortable with that.
Yes, of course, that's fine. Thank you. I think we need to use all of the levers at our powers, within our power, to increase loan parents' incomes and reduce costs. And we've heard about secure employment opportunities with better pay. We know that for loan parents that this is an issue, and particularly it's a gendered issue. We need the availability of childcare that works. We've talked a lot about childcare today, and we've welcomed recent funding announcements in relation to childcare, but we really do need it to be a stepping stone to a more strategic approach for the development of childcare as a whole. And we need to reduce costs for parents as well, be that the cost of school days, so for example, free school meals, vital that we retain them, transport costs, things like that. In terms of how we build the social security system, it's so important that it's accessible to the families who need to use it. And we've heard already about families who are not accessing the benefits that they're entitled to because they simply didn't know about them, or the complexity of the benefit system because it's delivered by UK and Scottish governments as well. This means that people have to apply to different agencies for different parts of benefits, and how do people know which ones to apply for and which ones lead to each one. So I think it's really important that as far as possible we automate the benefit system, not in terms of decision letters and computers and things like that, but in terms of people not necessarily having to make fresh applications all the time, that if they're entitled to one benefit, that leads to them being entitled to another one, that there's as much information from Social Security Scotland about the benefits that people can be entitled to and things like that.
Could be developed in many ways that would take quite some time, but it's very interesting. I think Martin was wanting to come in.
Yes, come in. Sorry, we have got an indication of people who want to come in. If you just forgive me for interrupting you there, and thank Kirsty for her contribution. However, before I do that, I believe Jeremy Balfour would like to come in. Thanks, Jeremy.
Yeah, thank you, Camina. I'm sorry to interrupt. I mean, lots of questions I would like to ask, but I just want to go back to one of the points James has made, and I don't know if any of the panel can help me on this. One of the things that we brought in with the Social Security Act was the entitlement for split payments, so the money didn't go to one individual, but it went to maybe the female. Now, obviously, with COVID, that seems to have got lost. I just wonder, does anyone within the round table have an update of where we are on that, and is this something we should maybe pursue with the Scottish Government? But I don't know if anyone has an update on it, because I don't, so I'm just interested to know where we are.
If no one can come in on it, can I maybe suggest, Jeremy, that we get in touch with Spice to see if information is available from there?
Yeah.
And we can produce
I just wondered if anyone was engaged in that with Scottish Government, but why not? Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Obviously, we spoke about kind of loan parent rates and legacy benefits and all. It's an old policy. Could the new policy not kind of assist loan parents in terms of, you know, the reintroduction of those rates? Just pop that out as well.
Okay, thank you. Giving us food for thought anyway. Thanks, Marie. Now, can I bring in Fiona? And following Fiona, I believe Martin wants to come in. Thanks.
It was just quite briefly, actually, on new policies. I think probably I would sort of gently push back on the premise that I don't think we need new policies. There's so much expertise across the country. There's so many projects. There's so many local services. There's networks of providers, local authorities, people around the room, but far more extensive than that, who have expertise of what works and how to reach families and how to pull all the threads together and really help to deliver improvements for families and help them unlock benefits, has been said. So I think probably my very general point would be to not throw the baby out with the bathwater. Maintain funding for projects where there's evidence that they work, but go back out into communities, which I think the Pathfinders are sort of doing in the Child Poverty Delivery Plan. But I'm not sure we need more Pathfinders. The Pathfinders are out there in communities. It's already happening. So it's maybe collecting that best practice and working with communities and importantly working with parents. I think we've tried very hard to bring the voices of parents into the room, but speaking to parents and finding out what works, because it's only then that you'll unlock the intricacies of people's lives, which mean that the policy intention isn't realised on the ground. So I think it is going out and speaking to parents, lone parents in this case, and understanding what works for them. But I think my other quite general point is to say that we've got a report coming out next month, which I'll share with the committee, with IPPR and JRF, looking at the societal and economic costs of poverty in Scotland. And I think that it would be intuitive to everyone in the room, but I think we need to look at like social security spend and other spend to reduce poverty as not a black hole. It's not benevolently throwing money into the black hole to help individuals, although, of course, there is individual benefit. But the money going into the Scottish Child Payment is being spent in communities. It's going back into our communities. It's being spent in local economies. The childcare money being spent is an enabler to employment. I think these things aren't siloed. So when making decisions about policies to be either extended or rolled out or maintained funding for, we need to look at the wider impact, because a lot of these things address not just lifting numbers of people out of poverty, but there's impacts on the attainment gap, on well-being, on mental health services, on public health, on the health budgets. There's multiple cumulative impacts of positive spend around poverty, and I think we need to maintain that when making policy choices.
Thanks, Fiona. Can I now bring in Martin? We still have another four people wanting to come in, so can you be as quick and as succinct as possible? Thank you.
It's a challenge, as people who know me well will tell you. It's a challenge, but I'll do my absolute best. Apologies if I speak particularly quickly. I'm just going to build, first of all, on the point that Fiona made, which is crucial and I think often gets lost in terms of the narrative around social security. An investment in social security that provides more money in the pockets of our children and families is an investment in our children and families. And I think we need to remember that. And as Fiona says, that's not money that goes into a black hole. It contributes to our economy, it contributes to our communities, and it makes sure that our children are able to get the things that they need. Thinking about policies, new policies or otherwise, I think it's important to think about some of the things we have committed to but haven't yet realised. We haven't yet touched on UNCRC, but I think it's an incredibly important point to remember that we have a universal commitment in this Parliament to committed to the incorporation of UNCRC, and that in itself will provide the framework and the accountability that will make sure that we follow through as a country on many of our choices and commitments, and that is crucial in terms of the work that we are doing and the commitments we've made to lift children and families out of poverty and to realise children's rights to food, realise children's right to play, realise children's right to live up in good quality housing. All those things will be much, much better achieved once we follow through with that commitment to UNCRC incorporation. So we would urge for that to happen quickly. And I know others have made that point as well. Coming back to some of the debt, discussion that we've had, some of the things that Aberlour have been calling for in relation to more action that we think can the Scottish Government can take in response to debt. And we've seen how we've heard this morning just how pervasive that is in terms of single parent families particularly. So we've called for a pause in public debt recovery in Scotland. We've actually called for a pause in public debt recovery across the UK, which there's a precedent for during the pandemic. But we've also called for the Scottish Government and local authorities to work together to do what they can to pause public debt recovery for initially at least 6 months to give some families breathing space and to provide them with some relief around the debt burden that is impacting on them right now in the midst of the cost of living crisis. As I've already touched on, we've been calling on cancelling school meal debt for all children across Scotland. We know local authorities have taken steps to do that unilaterally, which has really been positive. But that then, in and of itself, means there's now a discrimination amongst between different local authorities in Scotland. And so some children have benefited from that school meal debt cancellation. We want to see that extended, and we think the Scottish Government should be able to can and should do that for all children in Scotland. Alongside that, and as a preventative measure, then to also increase eligibility thresholds as well, which we think will then prevent school meal debt from accruing in the future for many of those same families. And also to provide flexibility and funding to local authorities to write off debt where necessary, where relevant, and where it's in the best interests of children and families and impacting on children's wellbeing. We want the commitment around keeping the promise to be followed through, particularly in relation to delivering whole family support for families. So the commitment to the funding that's been committed to by the Scottish Government, we want to see that realised. And we know that that is crucial in terms of responding to the immediate needs and the immediate impact of poverty on families, including many single-parent families. I think Cara and others have already talked on the Scottish Welfare Fund, so I won't go into detail about that. But the final point I would make around new policies or new actions that we think should be taken is to think about the particular groups and particularly vulnerable groups, including families with no recourse to public funds. And families with no recourse to public funds are again disproportionately represented in terms of the work that Aberlour does, responding to those needs and providing support through Urgent Assistance Fund. It's a group that will not shift the dial on child poverty statistics, but it's a group that are highly vulnerable and most at risk in terms of falling into poverty and destitution. And we think there's a lot more that can be done by the Scottish Government working in partnership with local authorities and using existing local powers to target support and help to prevent those families particularly from falling into poverty and destitution. So I would make the call for more action around those families, no families, no recourse to public funds.
Okay, thank you very much, Martin, for your contribution. Can I now bring in Satwa, followed by Cara? Thank you.
Thank you. I will also try to be brief, I promise. I think I'd also answered some of the things about actually we need to be looking at what's worked in the past that we're no longer doing, as opposed to thinking about what new things we need to do. I think there's a whole series of things we need to do in terms of the approach, though, to identifying what it is that's worked, why it's worked, and how we can bring it back, scale it up, replicate it. And in order to do that, I mean, I absolutely want to echo Martin's point about we need to be using what we have, and we have an approach here to developing a holistic whole family support, and that's going to be critical in how we're looking at supporting single parent families, because it will then integrate services from the perspective of what makes sense to the family, as opposed to the silos that we have, that we currently deliver services through, which adds to the complexity of the landscape for families. I think we need to be looking at analysis to make sure things are appropriate. So that's where I spoke about the intersectional approach being critical. Others have spoken about the complexity of the system, how difficult it can be for people to access the support that they're entitled to, that's available for them. So information, advice services, at places where the families are going to go, I think is absolutely critical for us to look at. Stigma and discrimination need to be addressed. These are some of the underlying things that will make policies fail, make initiatives fail, unless we do something about it. Lessons from COVID on the importance of partnership. And I think that none of us can do this alone. And at a time of restricted resources, we need to look to see how we work together more collaboratively, the role of the third sector, and how we can remove some of those barriers to delivery. I think if we do some proofing of policies, so for example, in this case, if we were to look at single parent proofing, so we're looking at what it is we're planning to do, but it's informed by the views of the parents who are affected. It makes sense to the single parents and their families, and it fits the complexity of their everyday lives. We're more likely to have successful initiatives rather than thinking about it from the perspective of what makes it easier for me to do it, sitting where I am within my institution. You asked about permanent things, things that can really make a difference. I mean, prevention obviously would be the ideal, and that's where we need to get to. But actually, the crisis is here and now, and the crisis measures need addressed. But that doesn't mean we wait for that before we start looking at some of the longer term preventative measures. They need to be happening at the same time. You know, we need to increase the baseline of income. And we've spoken about the Scottish Child Payment as a mechanism. There's also a minimum income guarantee working group and steering group, which has MSPs on it, as well as some of us from the third sector and other areas. There was talk about universal basic services when we were coming out of COVID. And there's the need, actually, for all this to be built on strong, dependable mainstream services. These additional measures to tackle specific experiences of particular priority family groups needs that foundation of strong mainstream services to build on. This shouldn't be about sticking plasters to fill gaps because there's cuts happening in mainstream services, essential services, but we need to be looking to see how we can do both. And there's income maximisation in the current system. We've heard about how much goes unclaimed. How can we simplify that, automate it, increase eligibility? And finally, I would just say we need to be looking at how we align employability with childcare, family-friendly working, flexible working, also look at rates of pay and hours of pay within that, because that's what's going to make the difference and stop it being a step from out-of-work poverty into work poverty. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Satwa. Can I now bring in Cara?
Thank you, Convener. And I would agree with others that I don't think this is necessarily about new policies. I think we know what changes we need to see. There's been a lot of policy papers published, a lot of consultations taken place, and many debates at Holyrood. But what we need is the policy solutions implemented. We need them scaled up to meet the challenges that Scotland faces, and we need the best practice that is happening in communities across Scotland better shared. I think we know, I mean, Gordon highlighted it before, that the UK government, as UK government policies that have had a detrimental impact, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't act, because children, families living in poverty now don't really care what level of government it is that's responsible. They need to see action, and they need to see the support in place now. And that's why at the Trussell Trust we really welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to develop an action plan to end the need for food banks. We really hope that is going to be published soon, because we think Scotland should be leading the way. That's why we're calling for more investment and expansion of the policies that we know are making a real difference to families, such as the Scottish Child Payment, such as the Scottish Welfare Fund, policies that we know work. So let's invest in them more. Let's realise their potential to end poverty and destitution in Scotland. That's why we support free school meals, so that no child in Scotland faces this stigma and that every child is ready to learn. That's why we need to see action to reduce the cost of the school day. That's why we need to see action to reduce the cost of living, invest in sort of flexible and free childcare, do more to make work pay and to make sure that everybody's got enough hours. And we would echo the calls that Martin has made and Aberlour have made around pausing public debt. And we also need to look at sort of disability. Obviously, Scotland has control now of disability benefits. We need to be using that to make a difference by scrapping things like the 20-metre rule, by sort of looking at the level of disability benefits to make sure they're adequate and make sure people have got the support in the workplace, because clearly there are a lot of barriers in place at the moment. So there is loads that we can do, and loads of the ideas have been mentioned here. But it's just about being bold and using the we need urgency, you know. But we also need policy change at UK level, and the Trussell Trust, together with the Joseph Rowntree Foundation and with the support of 90 charities across the UK, are launched a new campaign to reform universal credit, so that it always provides the support people need to cover the cost of life's essentials, such as food, utilities, vital household goods.
We know that right now 9 out of 10 low-income households receiving universal credit are going without one or more essentials. So we want to see, at UK level, we want to see the UK government reform universal credit so at the very least it covers the cost of essentials. And that deductions, for example, to the DWP can never pull support below that level. And that would mean increasing the rate from its current £85 a week to at least £120 a week. I think it's an absolute bizarre situation that we have a social security system that doesn't really reflect the costs that people face. And we need to reform that so that benefit levels reflect how much things actually cost. And obviously this is a mainly reserved matter, but we hope that the Scottish Government, we hope that Scottish political parties, we hope that committee members here will back these calls for a social security system that guarantees our essentials. But I mean, that is an absolute minimum. Our ambitions in Scotland, I think, also need to be much higher if we're going to secure the fairer, sort of more progressive future that we want to see here. Satwa has already talked about the minimum income guarantee for everyone in Scotland, and we know this isn't obviously a low-cost measure, but this is a measure that really would highlight the sort of different Scotland we want to see. And I think a minimum income guarantee would be the best way of ensuring that families in Scotland are protected from future crises. It would make sure that everybody has enough income from either work or social security to afford not just the essentials, but to afford a decent quality of life. So but obviously it comes at a cost, but that cost is so much less than so many children, so many families in Scotland growing up in poverty.
Okay, Cara, thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Laura, who's online, and following that, James Dunbar. Thanks.
Thank you. I just want to make a small additional point around employability. I think that over the next, well, this financial year, we're going to see an investment around parental employment into all the local areas in Scotland. And I think it's an opportunity we need to be really careful that we don't squander. And from our experience at Fife Gingerbread, I think there's three key things that we could really think about how we maximise that. I think we need to demand investment in lone parent specialist projects across Scotland. We know that works. It's evidence. So we must demand that that's part of the approach nationwide. I think there's links that are not used to community wealth building around progressive recruitment. So how can we fast track lone parents into good, well-paid, healthy jobs in our community anchor organisations? And the third point I would make around parental employment is we often just measure that success of these programmes with the number of people engaged and the number of job outcomes that were achieved, and we must be more sophisticated and cleverer with how we do that. We need to look at how we measure the success around tackling child poverty instead of just looking at those high-level data points. So that's my contribution. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And following James, our final speaker is going to be Morag. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Convener. I'll be really brief. It's almost a paradox I want to share. I hear a lot of really, really good policy, and I'm encouraged by the policy I'm hearing coming from the Scottish Parliament. But where I see the challenge, or one of the challenges, is consistent implementation of good policy. And the paradox is, I think we need to be consistent in how it's implemented or the outcomes we get from the implementation, but I'd love to see service being co-designed and shaped around what's different in each local authority area so that we get the right outcomes, because doing the same things in every area won't give you the same outcome necessarily. And all of that I would like to see shaped around the individual. That would be my...
Okay, thanks very much, James. And finally, Morag.
Thank you. I think every passing day that without these kind of interventions that we've all discussed today around the table, it's pushing more and more people to the brink, and significant reforms are needed, more so now than ever. Increasing the social security payments, looking at introducing a social tariff for the energy market. CABS deliver life-changing results. One in six people who sought advice with us last year saw a financial gain, the average financial gain being £4,200 better off. That could be vital money in that household for housing, employment, utilities. and them accessing their rights at the same time with regards to these subject areas. CAS recently published a good practice guidance for creditors to encourage creditors to foster more constructive practices aimed at helping people manage their finances as well as their mental well-being, rather than punishing them for not being able to keep up to date with payments. Noted in February this year, the mental health charity CME saw that 59% of people in Scotland say the cost of living crisis was impacting their mental health. This new CAS guidance was setting out 10 key principles and invites creditors to consider what they are doing and what they could improve in each area. And really what we would like to see, a broader change we would like to see around debt, is a more sympathetic, person-centred approach, helping people in arrears and debt so that the focus is what people can afford rather than what they owe. A similar approach to those who have mental health issues. And yeah, obviously these demographics, you know, include lone parent families. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Modag. So that brings us to the end of theme three. And can I just say a huge thank you for all your evidence today. And if there are any points that you have not had a chance to raise with us today, you're absolutely welcome to follow that up in writing. And I know that, you know, it's for me personally, it's brought up a lot of a bit more questions, and I'm sure for the rest of the members here as well. So that basically concludes our public business for today. We'll now move into private, and can members who are joining us remotely please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting. And a very huge thank you once again to everyone that's been here today, and for those of us that are online as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you.